changes to the, let's see, to the draft calendar? The agenda? Any changes? Move to accept the agenda as listed?
Second.
Any questions? Public? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Consent calendar, draft minutes of the regular meeting, March 14th.
I have one little typo.
Okay.
In under Parks and Recreation Matters, item three, it says that I commented Joe Renko. I commended Joe. D instead of T.
Gotcha.
Anything else?
On the claims, I have a question. The bottom of the first page, second, third line up, we're spending $15,000 on counselor shirts, or is that for camp and counselor shirts?
Mostly for campers. That's what 1,300 camper shirts, 1,300 campers, they each get two shirts to a cost.
How about that?
Okay, just wanted to check.
And I wanted to point out, the first time I've seen the overtime done, incredibly reasonable.
I think there was two shifts. I thought you'd appreciate that.
Wow. I do like that.
Can you explain what the EPAC emergency network is?
Yes, it's our emergency forms and software for our campers and after-schoolers. So parents, when they register for camp, will go on the EPAC, put in their kids' emergency information, dietary needs, etc. And then we have access to it throughout the school year and during the summer.
Is this new?
We've had it for 2 years now.
Oh.
Yeah, everybody's gone digital at this point.
How did we do it before?
A parent would turn in a paper form and then go in a folder, so the camp staff would carry the folder around. And then, you know, each week there's new campers, so you'd be going through trying to find. So this is a lot more efficient.
Is it available to people who are out in the park? Or do they have to come into the building for it?
So last year we implemented, the directors didn't have access, but they're super, we have four camp supervisors that are out there with iPads, and they all have access. And when they go on like field trips and what have you, we have access at that point as well.
I see.
It's getting to the point though where the directors are gonna have instant access.
I see, thank you.
Anything else?
The eucalyptus tree, was that an open space or the park?
Yeah.
Or the park?
The eucalyptus was an open space.
It was.
Right by the home on Miller Creek.
Okay, did it damage anything?
Yeah, it took out their fence.
Is this the fence guy?
Yeah. This was the second tree. There was two trees there.
One of them was for, the one on here actually was a living tree that we took out preemptively at the homeowner's bequest, and also we had tree masters look at it and just decided to take it out before it caused any more.
I see.
Caused any damage.
Okay. Thank you. And finally, Jay Riccardi, is this a second bill to finish up the audit?
No, you're looking at 859?
Mm-hmm.
No, it's a reissue of a lost check. So we sent them a check in January that they never received. So we had to cancel that check and reissue them.
So
this
is
not
further work or no.
No, this is not a further bill. This is simply a check that was voided out and reissued for them.
Okay, thank you.
So I agree. Yeah. Public.
You're on bills paid.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yeah.
Thank you. it's the one that's dated 3/8. I'm sorry, I don't have your number, but it's 3/8/17. And it's about the mold remediation. So that is for the kitchen, obviously, the mold in the kitchen, but the fire department. And what I wanted to find out is, Was that, did that follow the Public Works SB 854 law?
No, that was deemed to be an emergency situation to help. There's an exception on that.
Okay, thank you.
Steven?
Yeah, I also had a question about that. The total is about $6,500, and I guess vinegar and bleach costs a lot more. I'm really shocked at that bill. What was found there? Was this some special type of mold?
I can give you a copy of the report if you'd like.
Is it a special type of mold?
There was a number of different molds that were found.
Is it the black mold?
There's a couple different kinds of black molds, but yes, one of them was the bad mold.
What did you, it's so much money, it's just unbelievable to me. What all happened other than washing down walls? What was done to remediate that would cost $6,500?
It was done in a sealed environment. I'm not entirely sure. Again, I can give you a copy of the report.
Did they take the walls out?
Yeah, they took a bunch of stuff out.
And did they rebuild the walls?
No. That's.
So it's just down to the studs?
It's down, about half the kitchen is down to studs.
Anybody else? Call for the vote. Motion?
Yeah, I make a motion that we approve the consent calendar items.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Public comment open time for items not on the agenda. Ron.
There's an article in the paper that the county wants to spend over $1 million improving Lucas Valley Road up towards Big Rock. So many trucks won't go off the road. I called to complain to the Department of Public Works. I said they should put up a sign that said no trucks allowed over X number of feet long. And they said, well, the trucks would go anyway. Then I said, it's their problem. We don't want to do anything. I don't want to do anything to improve Lucas Valley Road to encourage more traffic. I said, you can spend this money better paving our streets. And they said, well, we can't do that because it's a grant from the government and it has to be used for that. It can't be switched to paving streets. I said, thank you, government, very much. So they're going to try and ease up some of the curves and switchbacks up there so the trucks won't continually go off the roads and not pay attention to the signs that say, if you're over a certain number of feet, please don't go. The sign doesn't say don't go, it just says please. So the hell with the truckers, leave the road alone.
Good try.
Yeah.
Thanks anyway. Anybody else? Linda?
Yeah. I'm going to read this quickly. In my opinion, last month the board made a very poor decision when choosing to give the district manager a 6% raise. And I'll explain that in a minute. That decision was fiscally irresponsible. The Marinwood District is in very bad shape financially and has been for years. When the district manager was hired, the new district manager was supposed to prove himself by taking the district out of its financial hole. This district manager has not done that, and I didn't hear any valid reasons last month to reward a learning on the job performance. A performance evaluation should take time, consideration, and honesty, honest thought. I saw and heard none of that at the board meeting. The 6% raise given to Marinwood's district manager is huge when you look at the fiscal demise of Marinwood. One board member suggested this raise, and the other four board members were too afraid to speak the truth and just rubber stamped Mr. Naylor's idea. A 4% raise would have even been excessive, but to give an additional 2% in an extra week's vacation is not well thought out. And Ms. Perry's statement that 2 weeks vacation is not much for someone with two children is both illogical and out of line. This district is not running smoothly and hasn't been for years. As someone who attends both board meetings and commission meetings, most of the board meetings and commission meetings, I see tiny improvements here and there, however, offset by many of the same problems. 6% was way too much. Thank you.
I think 6% was not enough. And as I spoke at the last meeting, I'm still happy to give the chief a raise, which he deserves.
Thank you. Steven?
Yeah, a couple things. First of all, I sent a letter to everyone except Irv Schwartz about pooling water on the roof. And I really wanted to send it to you, Irv, but because you're the only engineer and would actually understand perhaps on a different level than everybody else. But we have drainage issues up on the roof. If not addressed, they're going to cause problems. Shane told me today that there were some leads in the drain, which really, it still needs to be addressed, because if you've got standing water, you're going to have dry rot leakage and dry rot problems eventually. And if you have to do major work up there, it's going to be very costly for the district. So please address this aggressively now while there's time. Item number one. Item number two. Last week, I'm not going to pussyfoot around about this, but there was some crosstalk in the audience where I was personally engaged with. I really want the decorum of this body to be not, you know, a spitball fight, but actually an earnest exchange of ideas. We can have differing opinions, but we should maintain decorum and respect for each other and for the body. And then lastly, I had requested contact information, which I also sent out to everyone except Irv Schwartz. And I was denied that by Eric Trikosin. I believe that you, as public officials, you're required to have contact information, not just the phone box, or not just just a mailbox, but a voicemail box, but a way to actually have dialogue. The reason why I do written communication is to make a record of that communication. That's something that doesn't happen with voicemail. So I'll ask you, Irv, for your email address. But I would also like to see it published and your addresses published on the CSD. There may be reasons to contact you guys for whatever reasons. This is a question of proper role of government and the First Amendment. And you can't continually ignore the rights of the public. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. Anybody else? All right, moving on to district matters. We have a draft district budget for the coming fiscal year, 17-18.
Okay, good, thank you. As I put in the note, you know, there's been a handful of kind of changes, updated information, that has come in, things like we're able to get a more solid estimate on our general insurance rates, so on and so forth. Primarily, this budget doesn't have any large material changes from what you've seen last time. A lot of the time has been spent on really focusing on cleaning up the P&L chart of accounts within here. As you will see as you go through the chart of accounts, there's a few lines that have some strike-throughs on portions of those. Those are basically areas where I've cleaned up the chart. sitting down, working with the chief, working with Shane again, working with Carolyn, and looking at these, also looking at what specific expenditures were itemized in different accounts and realizing that they probably make more sense in other like accounts. So I think what we've achieved ultimately is having a P&L chart of accounts that is now going to be consistent across all departments, is going to have consistent types of expenditures across all departments, and it's just ultimately much cleaner. The other things that I've done is added a few lines, so those were also called out in my summary notes at the last page of the budget, and primarily beyond some of the more reticent P&L ones. At the request of the board, there's been a line added for OPEB trust contributions, and there's been an account line added for a capital reserves designation. Right now, each department just had $1 in there that I allocated simply so it would show up in the report, because if I don't budget the line, it doesn't show up. So that's simply nothing more than a placeholder at this point in time, and again, it's a draft budget. With that said, any questions, comments, guidance?
Yeah, I have a question. I'd like to, I've mentioned this before in board meetings, I would like to have $100,000 set aside in a capital reserve account. I'd like to know, during this budget process, can the board approve that, or do I need a specific agenda item for the board to discuss and potentially approve setting aside a capital reserve?
I do not believe you need a separate agenda item for that exact thing, because you're talking about in the context of the budget, which is a separate agenda item. Mm-hmm. I would say you're looking kind of for board consensus, and I'm happy to plug it in. What the board approves is the budget as a whole, and that'll happen next month.
Okay.
So all right. If you have, you know, I mean.
I'd like to just once again state, I think it is good policy to stop pay-as-you-go for capital assets and to start reserving to the extent we can. The department heads, myself, the district manager, went through a fixed asset projection over the next 10 years. The average amount annually came out to just about $100,000. Based on what we know now, we should also look at that on either a quarterly or a semi-annual basis to make sure that the numbers that we forecast at the time are realistic and have not changed. But I would like to just mention this so that we can consider that in our budget deliberations during the final meeting. I would also like to recommend that we discuss a monthly deposit to the OPEB trust account, starting with, say, $5,000 a month, and reviewed quarterly to either cease it, increase it, or decrease it. And those are the two items I'd like to look at and have the board either approve or reject during our budget deliberations.
Public hearing will be April 25th, so we'll have the budget, and then May 9th will be point of adoption, tentatively at this point in time.
Okay, cool.
Mr. President?
Yes.
Being a new guy on the board, I have a bunch of questions.
Ask away.
It appears that you've assumed that we're going to adopt the tax rate increase from this. Is that correct?
That is written into this draft, yes.
Okay, I'll be sure. Then when I look at your total budgeted in revenue as compared to expenses, it shows that the revenue is just over $322,000 more than expenses. And I keep hearing everyone saying that the district is in dire financial straits. I need some explanation.
Well, I can't explain dire financial straits to you, but I can certainly explain that, yes, right now, the way this budget is written, drafted, it does project a net revenue gain over expenditures of approximately $322,000. What I can also say is I don't expect large jumps in expenditures. I think we've done that. I do expect some levels of actual increases in what I'm going to project as revenues, and that mostly is going to come on the property tax side. The county previous years used to give a pretty detailed property tax projections for each fiscal year. They stopped doing that last year. I did get some level of guidance that says they are projecting current secured to increase between 4.5% to 5.5% over fiscal year 16, meaning not the fiscal year we're in now, but the previous fiscal year. They gave zero projections on any of the other tax categories. My intention with the current secured number was to project what I think we're going to be at the end of this fiscal year, and I would recommend setting that as the benchmark. It's actually a little bit more than the 5.5 over actuals received for fiscal year 16. We received $799,135 as of December 31st. In theory, that's supposed to represent 55% of our total current secured tax take. When you do out the math, that would give me a 17-18 estimate of roughly $1.45 million as opposed to what I have budgeted of $1.372. So that's, you're looking at about an $80,000 increase there.
Okay, next one. On page four, you have consultant fees. And I'm a consultant, so I'm always interested in that.
Okay.
What kind of things, this is the park budget, what sort of things are they using consultants for?
Well, the consultant line, it actually goes more across the entire district and all departments, and it's primarily for work that we have to do to have our GASB 68 reports produced. GASB 68 are your pension valuation reports that come off of CalPERS information that has to be incorporated into each annual audit. There are also a small amount for accounting consulting that's also written into there. That's pretty much the beef of the two things, and it's a district-wide expense.
So you just allocated. You prorate it to each department?
Correct.
Okay, moving on. Page five.
Okay.
You show a rather large increase in maintenance park heavy equipment.
Yes.
What's the park heavy equipment?
Tractor, lawnmower, things along those lines. We were calling heavy equipment just mostly to delineate it from the other line down here that was just equipment and maintenance and replacement. And that was kind of, Shane and I spent a lot of time kind of looking at that and thinking what it should be. As you can see, actual were much higher than we projected them last time. I hope to come under that, but I'm also trying to be realistic that we may have a we just have older equipment.
Okay. The next item down, community landscape contract, that's going to go down?
No, it's actually just a more realistic budget expectation. It's overstated at 40,000. It's not quite 40,000. That was the round number I inherited in this year, and really going through this line by line by line, trying to make more accurate projections. The landscape contract is more what I have written in for 17-18. The same exact contract, hasn't gone up nor down. They're just happy to keep us around, so they haven't suggested us paying more.
Okay. On the fire department, page 8,
okay,
with paramedic reimbursement, $22,000. What is that?
Yeah, well, that very well might not be received. So written into this budget is also paramedic incentive. We have a shared services agreement with the City of San Rafael that if and when paramedics are implemented, basically comes out of the paramedic tax paid by Marinwood residents that San Rafael received. So part of the shared services agreement is they reimburse for those costs for paramedics. So it is written in there. Right now we have two paramedics on staff because I am representing what is San Rafael's rate for a paramedic incentive, which is 10% above base wage. That is written in to the salaries, as is the thing. It's me preemptively accounting for paramedics coming in.
Because what I was wondering if it was, I remember when I got the services of the paramedics, some months later, I got a bill.
No, that
the city collects that money. Does any of that come back to the district?
That is that is a great question. And that if you look under also within here, you will see emergency response fees that were budgeted for 16-17 but have zero actuals as of 3/31. And I can let the chief speak more to this, but we've certainly been talking to them. When a paramedic comes out, it doesn't come to the district because we're not the ones sending the paramedic. So if an ambulance shows up, that's coming from San Rafael Fire. So they're the ones who are billing you. What we're trying to discern to a degree is if they are or have or could bill when we respond, and we haven't come to that conclusion yet.
You can do an engine company response bill. The district has passed an ordinance allowing us to do that. But for us to complete that process, I'm trying to get a Medicare number, which is extremely complicated. And I'm working out details with Joyce, who does their billing in San Rafael, and also seeing if they could issue the bills for us to our residents. So it's a third party billing, it's double dipping. Everyone's doing it. We have the ability to do it. We haven't implemented it yet. It's a goal of mine in the next year. And they only charge the insurance company. So,
but they don't tell you that when you get the bill the first time.
Well,
until you go and ask them.
Right. If your insurance company doesn't pay, then they don't go after homeowners to collect. And neither would
that really information doesn't. Like I said, I found out about that after a number of letters. What happens if they go out on the highway to someone that doesn't live in San Rafael as a district?
They still send them a bill.
Do they insist on collecting there, or they drop it also?
Same thing.
Okay. Utilities, water and sewer is going way up. I assume they've raised the rates considerably.
They've raised the rates.
They're going to do it again.
Well, it's going way up because during the last fiscal year, what they wound up doing was fixing a broken meter. It happened to be a meter that we use the most. So for 5 or 6 years, we were severely underbilled for water, and sewer is based on water.
Sorry, Ash.
But all right, it's been explained, is why I chuckle, but that's the issue. These are good questions.
Instead of my marks at this point.
Can I respond to one of his questions? For one of the reasons that you see such wildly profitable numbers on this budget is because most of the expenses that we're incurring are transferred to the balance sheet. And in terms of unfunded liabilities and our predilection to pay as you go instead of reserving properly, both for capital assets, for healthcare benefits in the future. And when the actuarial report comes out from CalPERS in June, we're going to see increased expenses there as well. So these numbers will change.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, my concern is, I guess, that there's some people that are, at least one, that is objecting to the increasing the tax rate. But the budget, when you just look at it cold as the budget, it doesn't look like we really need it. So it seems like we ought to be budgeting for these unfunded items and come up with a balanced budget, seeing if we do or don't really need the tax rate increase.
Well, I think to Jeff's point, this is simply just a P&L budget operating 1 year. And it doesn't give you a good snapshot of the balance sheet. That's something I'm still working on resolving. So within the balance sheet, it would clearly show those levels of unfunded liabilities that do show within the audit. I can pull that number for you. I don't have it off the very top of my head, but I can tell you what we're about 2.5, I think, in pension, and somewhere close to that in health as well. So it'd show you about 5 million in unfunded liabilities, I believe. But don't quote me to those numbers.
Unfunded liabilities right now are approximately the same as an annual budget.
But have we shown somewhere, or do we know if we were to put away so much money every year for X number of years, we would get it back in proper relationship to everything?
Through the homework that we did and some of the presentations and eventually the adoption of the OPEB trust, showed that to a degree, but has it shown how much we would need to put away every year for X number of years so that we had zero unfunded liability? No, it hasn't shown that. But to that point, not to say it shouldn't be done, I think there's one city, municipality in the entire state of California that has zero unfunded liability at this point in time. Again, not an excuse, simply a statement of fact.
It just seems like this information ought to be somehow...
I don't disagree with you.
...resolved somewhat before we move on to that other item that we're going to talk about tonight.
Well, I don't disagree with you. I think if you look at this as a one-year operating and revenue thing, which is what this district has kind of traditionally done in looking at this, and I think that's a lot of what the board and myself have been working on in terms of saying there's a bigger picture at play.
I see.
If that makes sense.
I think so.
Okay.
I just want to know when we're going to get done playing.
Anybody else? And again, you're working on or hoping to receive from the county some updates on to help you project revenues.
For taxes?
Mm-hmm.
I am. If I don't receive those any further than I've done, what I would recommend is taking the projection that I have that I just gave you for 17-18 for current secured, that would put us at about 1.45. If I take their 5.5% increase over 15-16 actuals, that would actually put us at 1.44, difference of about $10,000 when it's said and done. But I think that their projections are looking countywide. I would be comfortable with either, and I would probably recommend the more conservative approach for a budgeting standpoint, especially on a revenue side, because they tend to be more conservative in looking at that than saying, oh, we're going to get all of this. But this year I'm projecting to get more at the end than what they are projecting for next year, specific to our tax base. Yeah, you're welcome. The other thing I want to point out, too, is... This is more about budget and less about actuals, but it should be noted that within the actuals for the summer rec program, which is 463-1920, we did some down and dirty math last week that showed about 315,000 of those revenues stated in here are actually going to be deferred to 17-18 because that's for services that won't be rendered until after July 1st. Those moves will certainly be made at end of fiscal year and be represented, presented to the auditor for the end of year audited financials. The other number is 463-1918 pool memberships. About 16,000 of what is currently stated in here is due to be deferred to 17-18 as revenue. With that said, I would also point out 463-1920 is about 105,000 over projected budget, and that's non-deferred. And that number is growing every day. It puts about 18.5 to go on full memberships, but this, again, was, even though it says as of 3/31, it wasn't every transaction up until 3/31. I think the last transactional check we got from this from our registration system was probably closer to about 3/15. Now the pool's open. Memberships have increased dramatically, plus we have whatever came in. The way it works is when they pay, especially via credit card, which is 90% of the payments that we get, it goes through the registration system. They process it all. They take their cut. They send us a check. When we get the check is when it's recorded into the financials. If that makes good. So those I think are performing pretty good. I have Director Naylor's comments here, which would be for further board discussion. And then I'll let those kind of meetings and other comments happen. I have a couple other things before we move on.
The increase in the PERS.
Increase in PERS.
It's only 9%?
Well, district-wide, projected, yes. That's a combination of what is projected off of payroll, as well as what is not projected, but what is known in terms of the lump sum unfunded liability amounts that we are being charged this year. I would anticipate.
Get higher.
This year? No.
Come.
This year, just based on payroll, no, and the lump sums are set. Next year, it's going to increase dramatically. For not 17-18, but 18-19, that's going to be primarily due to the already expected increase in the unfunded liability lump sum payments, as well as the reduction in the discount rate that will be impacting us for 18-19, at which point I would expect just that move alone to increase these by 5% on top of what it was already going to increase by.
Remember also when the CalPERS audit comes out in the July timeframe,
right,
the last return on investment was less than 1%. That will also drive up that number.
Absolutely.
Will they adjust our ARC payments based on that?
Yeah, they'll allow.
Annually required contributions will go up.
Mm-hmm. The way that those numbers are not set, they have released small preliminary projections before they made the announcement about reducing the discount rate. So the discount rate will go down, I believe, to 7.25 next year, and then 7.125 the year before that. It's going to be phased in over 3 years. The projections that we have were based on a 7.5% discount rate that they were using, not what eventually is going to become a 7% discount rate. So the ARC payments are going to go up, as well as the employer rates based on payroll are going to go up. And they would go up to just 0.2 of the grossly missed, the 7.5% expectation return on investment.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. How's the public doing? Oh, I mean, Stephen.
So I just want some clarity on the revenue side and the property tax increase and what you said. You're representing that we have 6% revenue increase due to property taxes?
No, in this budget right here, or?
Let me say this. Let's do 16-17 and what we know.
Okay.
Up to this point, over the previous year.
15-16. Okay.
So, real estate went crazy during that time. Mm-hmm. I know I got hit with a huge tax bill. I was just curious what you saw in the district in terms of revenue.
Well, for 16-17, like I said, we received that $799,000 as of 12/31. And that's simply for current security. This isn't the supplementals. This it's the big one.
Well, so what I'm saying is percentage increase, the actual amount.
I wouldn't be able to give you the percentage increase off the top of my head. What I can tell you is 15-16 actuals for current security was 1.37 roughly, and I'm looking at 16-17 coming in closer to 1.45. So doing that dirty math, you know, 1.37 to 1.45, you're looking at about 50-60,000.
That's it?
Increase, yeah, in secured.
My bill went up 20%. So I, you know. Also, but you're not including the special taxes.
No, I'm not including special taxes.
And those are CPI.
Those are CPI based. Yes. What I have written into here, there's two things. You bring up a good point, Stephen. So if you look at fire, it goes up by exactly 3.5% because that's what the CPI is, and that's what the board will be discussing later on. Park is higher. That's because park was under budgeted last year. There was actually no increase in the park tax rate last year, but the board and the voters actually passed a new ordinance that recalculated what it was based on. It went from parcel to unit. As a result of those unit increases, which at the time we didn't have those numbers for the 16-17 budget, we were under budgeted by roughly $5,000. So that was what that change did off the bat, and that was 98% driven by the commercial properties in the area. I think there was less than 10, probably closer to 6 actual residents that had two units on file with the county, meaning, you know, second, a granny unit or something like that, they qualified as a unit.
So I'm just trying to think, because we've had a big recovery in the market. Have the projections given to you increased from the county, or are they?
Well, that's just it. The county gave no projections last year. And the rationale behind that was because they were pretty much chin deep in dealing with their own accounting system transition, and the people who normally do that were busy trying to work them off the staff into this. They gave nothing. This year, the only projection I've received from the county is a 4.5% to 5.5% increase in current secured, just the one tax line, over fiscal year 16, meaning over what was actually received last fiscal year. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Anybody else? Okay, then.
Before you move on, go. In looking at this budget, and I did run some numbers, and I looked at three individual employees in particular who are not on a step system or not part of a collective bargaining or not. Or I don't want to say they're not on a step system. They've been maxed out on the step system for quite some time. So they are no longer eligible. That would be Chief Roach, Shane DeMarta, and Paula Collins. I ran some basic numbers, and they give you some round numbers. And looking at a 2% increase across the board for all three of them would bring a burden cost of roughly $7,000 to the district for this operating year alone, and that is burdened across, takes account of PERS, everything else. That I would certainly recommend entertaining that. I think I don't have the exact dates in front of me on when the three of them have each received any level of wage increase, but I can tell you that it was before my time here. So it's been at least two, probably 3 years. If they want to comment on it, they're welcome to. I don't want to put them in that position right now. But I would recommend that the board consider authorizing that.
Is that something that would have to be on the...
It would be a separate agenda item. I'm just giving you numbers right now. I would put it through. You'd have to approve a pay scale that would do it. And again, it would be a separate agenda item for a wage increase for those three employees beyond what their current... pay scales have them at.
Okay.
And that would be an agenda item in what meeting?
I would do it in the next meeting. I would do it
April 25th? Or the May 9th or whatever it is.
I would do May 9th. Mm-hmm. I would put it as a placeholder for April just to show that that's what it is. But what I, like I said, when I ran the math, it's just shy of $7,000 total burden across for this operating year for 17-18. If you were to make it effective July 1.
Totally absorbed, including?
Fully burdened. That's the PERS effect. That is in terms of post-employment, meaning?
Pension.
Pension, yeah. Well, that's what I say when I say the PERS effect. Mm-hmm. In terms of pension, in terms of workers' comp, OPEB wouldn't change because health is health.
Right.
And that's a flat number anyway. Okay. This would be, again, workers' comp. This would be payroll taxes paid by the employer. It would be Social Security, Medicare, things like that. And those are really the only ones that fluctuate within a outside of wage itself.
Thank you for clarifying. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. That would be on next month's agenda.
I'd like it to be.
Decide now.
You can certainly discuss it now, and you can certainly provide direction. It can be asked as an agenda item for future agenda when you get to that point, and I can lay out the exacting numbers across the board for each three.
Mm, okay. You're done with the budget now?
I believe so.
Okay. Resolution 2017-03, increasing the amount of a special tax for fire protection emergency services.
Can I ask a question before we get into this?
Sure.
We're currently down one board member, so just in the interest of clarity, these are resolutions that require just a simple majority, is that correct?
Correct.
Okay, if there's a 2-2 vote, the motion fails.
Correct.
Okay, I just wanted to clarify, thank you. Mm-hmm.
So these are, let's just start with 2017-03. This is the special tax for fire protection, written into the voter approved resolution that went on the ballot in 2011, November 8th. The district may increase this tax by the level of CPI for the previous calendar year. Some historical CPIs. In 13-14, CPI was 2.2%. In 14-15, 2.6. 15-16, it was 2.7. 16-17, it was 3.2. And for 17-18, it is 3.5. To give you a little perspective on total effect, because when you read, it'll increase by 0.0109 cents per square foot. For a 1,500 square foot house, the annual increase would be $16.35. For a 2,000 square foot house, it would be $21.80. And for a 2,500 square foot house, it would be $27.25, the annual number increase over whatever they're paying now.
Couple of questions?
Go for it.
If we were to pass on, or not pass this resolution tonight, if next year we found we needed more money, can we go back and pick up what we didn't do this year?
I don't believe so.
Yeah, I don't
believe so. You would have to look at it again next year and see what that previous calendar year CPI.
You can only increase it by the CPI.
I think I have the exact language in here. May be increased by resolution of the Board of Directors for each fiscal year by a factor not to exceed the Bay Area All Urban Consumers Consumer Price Index for December 31 of the year preceding the start of the fiscal year. So I don't think you can double it up and say, we'll give a break, but then we're going to go 7% the next year.
Okay, next question. Is there a time schedule relative to having to do this tonight?
The time schedule would be typically this information has to be submitted. The deadline for the rates go usually the very first week of July to the tax department and the assessor's office, who calculates all of these and then puts it into the tax roll and sends out the tax bills. So you would need it by that information, by that point in time. Furthermore, if this doesn't move, then I would adjust the budget, which is set for adoption next month.
And it's about $57,000.
Okay.
If my math is in.
I would have to look. But if you say so, for just fire?
Just fire.
No.
Or for both?
Both. It was 17 for parks and...
Well, I could tell you right now, if they all fall under the same thing.
Yeah, district total about $53,234.
Okay. Yeah, it would basically bring it back down to 1,387,247, with the exception of if, according to the county's assessor's office, square footage has grown. Mm-hmm. Does not happen very much here because you're... Most add-ons are maybe a couple hundred square feet. There's certainly not any new developments being built at this point in time.
I'm trying.
Yeah. I wish you luck.
Poor Sal. I'm supposed to have 20. I have a comment then, and that is I need some information from either Eric or the other board members as to, the thing that I mentioned before, this issue of the unfunded obligations of the district and why, based on at least just looking at this budget by itself, we don't need this extra money. If you just look at it itself.
But as Eric said, that's a one snapshot, one sliver of our financial
picture. I need to understand why we need the increase.
Sure. Well, and I'm not going to, what I would say in addition to what we've talked about in terms of the long range unfunded liabilities is, And again, I think this is...
Sorry, my bad.
I think that this is being resolved to some degree, but, you know, this board, this district has never established any level of reserves, has no level of operating reserve, and cannot make it through a fiscal year on a cash flow basis without going into the red and borrowing money from the county. At the end of the year, we usually turn out okay, but we have, that's just where the district stands from a financial standpoint right now, is by November, we're borrowing money from the county until the first round of taxes come in.
Well, let me ask another question, maybe that will help me.
Sure, please.
At the end of this fiscal year, will there be a budget surplus?
I'm projecting there to be. I do not think it'll be quite as high as what we budgeted for. We've just been hit with other expenses that weren't budgeted for, yet we've also experienced gains in revenue. So that'll all, you know, kind of looking through those projections is part of the game.
Okay, well, if we have a budget surplus, is it going to go into some kind of reserve funds, or what's...
Well, I think that's what we're trying to accomplish when all of a sudden we're now have lines and are looking at capital reserve designations and post-employment trusts. Capital reserve designations technically will stay within the general fund, but those expenditures will be moved to a balance sheet to show that in there. We can't necessarily put it into a separate investment vehicle because we borrow money from the county. We can't tell the county we need to borrow money from you, but we have this chunk of money over here that's getting higher interest rate than what we pay you to borrow money. The OPEB trust is protected.
So if we have a surplus and put that into some kind of fund,
correct,
we can use that to deal with our cash flow issue.
Sure.
But it's when we come out of the cash flow problem, we have that money that can be used to deal with our unfunded pension liabilities, mm-hmm. and to put some money away for capital. Okay.
Let me correct that. You cannot take the, once you put money in an OPEB trust, you can only take the money out of the OPEB trust for the reason that it is in there for, and that is to pay retiree health care costs, which we have currently at about $11,500 a month. If you, by simply moving this to a balance sheet account, it absolutely stays within the general fund, and you would have to draw down on that from a cash flow perspective before we would enter a dry period loan with the county, simply because the money is in our county treasury account. Get that. I hope I explained that to you properly.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
That's what's been called in the past fund replenishment.
Yes. You're exactly right.
Yeah.
I had one question for her. Both the fire and the park, this money that comes in, this special tax, can only be spent for that designation?
Correct.
It cannot go into our general...
Correct.
Portion.
I mean, it does go into the general portion, but at the end of the day, the expenses of both of those departments far outweigh the revenue that this brings in. That revenue, like, if park brought in $300,000, but it only costs us $250,000 by which to operate the parks department, you'd have a concern. But this is less than half of what it costs to operate the parks department. That's why each department is also offset by general tax revenue.
Okay. Thanks.
All right. All right. I move that we approve resolution 2017-03, increasing the amount of the special tax for fire protection and emergency services.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second it. Now we can discuss.
We can.
Okay, I'm aware of a letter written by one of our constituents objecting to this fee or this tax increase, and frankly, I sympathize with it. For all intents and purposes, a couple of things just to note. This is a resolution with an annual CPI that was approved by the voters. so it should not be a surprise. I think a lot of this is because of the current environment we're in, where we have agencies in this county that are able to pass on tax increases or fee increases to the citizens without any vote at all by the citizens, and without any means of recourse that's meaningful. Writing a couple of letters to the Marinwood, or I'm sorry, the Marin Municipal Water District does very little good. I think they're an example of a not very well-managed organization that uses whatever justification comes to mind for their increases. No citizen has the ability to actually meaningfully object to that increase. I think they've sort of discounted the intelligence of the Marin voters or the Marin taxpayers, because they're asking for these increases so close together. We don't forget, we're getting these increases left and right. So that's how we differ. That's how we differ with the Marin Municipal Water District. This resolution with its CPI was actually voted in by the taxpayers in this and the voters in this district. But what we do have in common with the Marin Municipal Water District is the reason why we continue to have to increase our revenues, and that is because of the unfunded liabilities. Unless we are able to come to some sort of agreement to reduce the impact of the CalPERS pension, we are headed to a point where we're going to have to discuss whether or not we maintain an independent fire department. That's it. Anybody else?
I don't see this as a, I mean, I don't think anybody likes having their tax bills be higher, but I don't see this as political. This is how business is done. And you can skip, I remember having this discussion about camp prices years ago, and I remember saying to Shane, just increase it every year. Don't not increase it and then do a huge bump, because you miss all those little bumps along the way. So I think that this is, would be penny wise and pound foolish not to approve it. You know, again, it was in the ballot before. These are usually routine approvals that are not met with public resistance or outcry. So I am absolutely in favor of this. I mean, as much as I don't like my tax bill to go up, this is what community and running CSD means.
I think understanding that the voters voted to do this already makes it palatable, but I still am concerned as it relates to the budget and how we put money aside just to start whittling down the unfunded pension balance, and how we put money aside so that we don't get in trouble when we need to do something like remodel a firehouse kitchen.
Yeah, if this passes, what will the rate be in Marinwood? 31 cents a square foot?
Yes.
31.
It shall be 0.3220 per square foot.
Okay.
32 cents. They make you take it all the way out to a fourth digit. Basically 32 cents.
32.
Yeah, 0.3220. It was 0.3111. So it'll go from 0.3111 to 0.3220.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Steven?
Well, the way I understand it, this is the approval that would have come in the November election. And I don't believe you have the legal authority to approve this and go ahead. You gave yourself an extra year as board members without voter approval, and now
I guess this was supposed to be an election. Now you want to also speak on behalf of the voters to increase their taxes. And I don't think that's hunky-dory. I don't think that's a legal thing. And if you go forward with it,
May I ask a question?
Of me?
Yes.
Yeah, sure.
Did you read the resolution?
Why don't you ask the question that is on your mind?
Because it says that the general election that was held on November 2011 was passed by the voters. This is where this comes from.
Which, as the way I read it, it expired to 2017. Okay. We've been voting on this every 2 years to reaffirm this. And now this year, because you guys wanted to, quote-unquote, save money on election, you're bringing it on your own self to raise the taxes. I don't think that's right. Now, I may be wrong on that. You know, maybe I didn't read it right, maybe I didn't understand it right. But, I mean, we're getting hit with higher water, higher sewer, gas taxes. We're going to have housing taxes. We're going to have all kinds of things, as Jeff has spoken to. And, you know, you want to take another little nibble at the apple, go right ahead. But this will not be a smooth tax increase, not this time. It's got to stop. There's got to be, you know, this firehouse, the kitchen, putting in granite fire thing, $5,000 for remediation. Now I want, of course, our fire service to be, the firehouse to be up to standards, but it really, really appears like we get more money in and more money gets spent, and there's always more desires to spend money than there is to actually save money and make us fiscally whole. My goal for our community is to make sure that we keep our promises to our employees and we maintain our beautiful parks and our community structure. I don't see it happen, because just like the person with the credit card or the checks, you know, I have more checks, how can I be broke? It just always seems that there's more need out there, and we need to adopt more fiscal discipline. Perhaps because are not doing this election this time, put it in the following election, you know, keep faith with the voters and don't take advantage of this particular election cycle.
I can provide some clarification. So the original measure written as it was passed in 2011. Every 4 years, what's known as the GAN limit requires that it goes back on and becomes reauthorized. In 2015, this measure was Measure H, in which the voters reauthorized this tax for another 4 years, with the CPIs effective year one being the year that we're in right now, 16-17. So it gives you 16-17, 17-18, 18-19, 19-20. So in November of 2019, this would, in theory, need to go back on the ballot again for another reauthorization of what's known informally as the GAN limit, which would then grant another four-year voter-approved authorization of this tax.
So we'll actually always collect the tax. The GAN limit allows us to spend it.
Right. So this was on the ballot in 2015. It was Measure H.
And, excuse me, but are increasing our terms by 1 year aren't really affecting this? It might, the next time, if we had increased it by 2 years, maybe it would have. But 1 year, because if we're going to vote on it
now. You would be voting on this now regardless of if you were up for election in November or the following November.
This isn't something that needs to go to the voters. They've already approved it.
This wouldn't be on the ballot regardless of any changes.
Okay.
But our changing our voting schedule, our election.
But to be clear, this measure again, to be reauthorized for another 4 years, should the board so choose, would have to go on the ballot by 2019. In theory, I would, and again, we're stretching this conversation farther than it really needs to go, would probably recommend bumping that up by a year and moving into 2018 to consolidate with what's going to be a much larger election to bring down election costs. With that said, it doesn't need to go on until 2019, November of 2019, to be effective for fiscal year 2021.
But even if it were moved to the 2018 election, it's beyond our new expanded terms.
Correct.
To make the decision about
it. Correct.
It has nothing to do with one or the other. Okay. Seems pretty straightforward that the voters wanted this, actually both of these resolutions. So for 17.3, I call for a vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 And for resolution 2017-04, this is the park, I believe, open space, street landscape maintenance. Same thing, CPI, 3.5%.
Correct, correct. So of note, I mean, it's written in here, but that would be a $6.63 increase per unit on an annual basis. It should be noted that the park rate did not increase from last fiscal year to the fiscal year that we are in right now because the measure was changed. The rate stayed the same. So the vast majority of homeowners, all except, like I said, less than 10 or so that have a second unit on record with the county, paid the exact same rate for 2 years in a row, 15-16 and 16-17.
So this is calculating an increase of $6.63.
Correct.
Question?
Yes.
Are we aware of any illegal second units in the area?
No.
Okay.
I'm not aware.
Are you?
No. But in other neighborhoods, they're more obvious. I think this one.
No, the data is taken from what's on the county assessor's tax roll.
Okay. For a motion.
I move that we approve resolution 2017-04, increasing the amount of the special tax for park open space and street landscape maintenance.
Second. Discussion. Same thing.
I have nothing for that.
Yeah, same. Okay.
Public, Stephen?
I want to remind you, you guys voted yourselves an extra year. Now you're voting on behalf of, I believe, illegally. And I believe we have the right, we have the authority. I'm going to check it out. But and if we need to get big guns in here to make the point, we'll do it. But I really think you can just think about this in a logic standpoint. This is not the year to stick it to the taxpayers. This is the year to make some of the substantive changes like Jeff was talking about, setting aside funds for capital expenditures and looking towards trimming costs. That way, your year, extra year on this council will be worth it. But this way, it really looks like you're just sticking it to us like petty tyrants.
Eric, on the clarification, this was the latest thing that was passed in 15.
This was Measure I in 2015, okay. So it had the exact same terms. This is in effect for 4 years. Your ability to raise CPI would have to go on to reauthorize this tax, which is known as a special tax. This is different than a imposed tax, such as like what Marin Municipal Water District charges. Right. Special taxes have to be approved by the voters, 2/3 majority. This one passed, I think, by a little over 75%.
Okay. So, anything else in the public? update on the ad hoc committee to review, revise, create district policies, and that was by Isabella, so I guess it's kind of go by the wayside tonight.
Well, it can certainly be discussed. The drafted policy was included in here. The purpose of it primarily is to set expenditure authorization limits by staff as well as some board guidelines. This was certainly modeled after other districts' policies and is pretty much kind of a standard practice. We do not have any current stated policy on this. I would also say that I know Director Naylor took a look at this before it went in as well, and he may certainly wish to comment on any of the things that were in here. We kind of, again, went through, looked at what the standard practices were amongst like-type agencies. There are certainly some outstanding questions that I would have with how this is currently written, and I think it omits certain things that is not currently called out, such as current contracts, things like our health bill and everything else that we write a check for every single month to bring for an explicit board approval would seem a little redundant on those levels. I think some language changes in here in looking at the 25,000 and over, really making sure that it addresses, I'm not sure if bid is the proper term when you're looking at comparison of the cost of goods. I think it would probably be more into a cost comparison analysis done. I mean,
goods are good. I was going to bring up insurance.
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But most of those are generally approved because they're within, through the budget they come out. The lump sum UAL payments are discussed by the board. But in my mind, these are things that would certainly need to be looked at, and then most likely also more clearly defining a budgeted item versus a non-budgeted item and how that is defined or captured.
Are you inserting any language into this?
Not at this point in time, I'm not. These are just, as I gave it a read and wrote through my notes, so these are certainly questions I would have. I would encourage any feedback. I have not personally shared this with them or talked with them about this, but I'm assuming they've kind of read through it and looking at the packet. Chief and Shane, two department heads, may certainly have some thought feedback or input into it.
I think it looks good, especially to public works projects. That provides some additional guidance for me moving forward.
Yeah, there was, with regard to the full-time employees, maximum 500, I think we've had the discussion about the fact that there are standing agreements with certain approved vendors in which we'll, an employee that is not a supervisor or a department head can make an order and later be invoiced for it. And this is a practical thing that goes on during the season. We'll need to sort of just spell that out a little bit more clearly as to why that limit is there. But for all intents and purposes, all it does is basically say, hey, if you go above a certain limit, take it up to the next level and make sure that they're cool with it, particularly the non-budgeted items, the surprises. So this is a hole in our policies that I'm glad to see on its way to being filled.
I will say too, in kind of looking at what the limits are, from a practice standpoint, I think that this exists in large part already. In looking at, say, what the recreation supervisors or fire captain's limit is, I think anything above that they would discuss with the chief prior to anyway, or with Shane prior to anyway. And I know that they're generally very good about bringing things my way when you start to get up into the 5,000 and above line. And if anything, I think I've erred on the side of caution as to what I bring to the board within the public meeting setting in terms of here's some expenditures that we're looking at, most especially on a non-budgeted, non-planned expense. But like I said, I think it, personally, as I reread this a few times, could use, some level of when does something become budgeted? What does that mean? How is it documented within as a budgeted expense or a non-budgeted expense, so on and so forth?
We don't forecast here.
Not well.
Yeah. So, in other words, what that means is we do a budget at the beginning of the year, that's it. You know, we don't go back all that often and recalculate the quote-unquote budget based on information that comes available.
Well, and with that said, there will be most likely to go along with the adoption of next year's budget some levels of budget amendments, even though we are not required to make them in the way we were in years past, because the county would put a hard stop. It's still a better practice, as you're noticing those things, to bring them to before you just at the end of the year say, oh, we've overshot this one by X amount, to say, here's what it is, I recommend a budget amendment of Y, so on and so forth. So that way the final budget at the end of year reflects more of what is actual and has been discussed in an open public forum and has been approved by the board.
Right.
But with that said, that's forecasting within one fiscal year, not a long term.
That's correct. Yeah, understood.
We're getting there. I honestly think we've made a lot of strides in that direction.
I think it's interesting that the district, how long it's been in business, if this is the first time this has been put together, but I think it's good. I think it's good that it's happening. Just maybe you'll think of this as silly, but a number of spots, most spots you put capital D any place you said district, but not all spots. And if you look through on the I-1, both in the A paragraph and the B paragraph, it's missed. Once each, and this is big stuff. On 2E, it's missed, and I probably missed some other spots. So also relative to consistency, if you go to the budgeted items on Roman numeral 1, number 1, A says that the employee is an authorized purchaser, but B says shall authorize purchases, and C says shall authorize purchases. That makes sense if they're pushing it up the line, kind of. But I would think that the recreation supervisor or fire captain, based on what this says, is also an authorized purchaser for anything between $500 and $1,500. There's some semantics I think needs to be played with a little through this document.
Some refinement.
Refinement's a good word.
Well,
the concept is really good, though.
I agree with the concept, and I really appreciated the font. Something about the bold and the size of it, like the aesthetic quality of it, I quite liked. I don't know exactly what that is, but...
Well, that's what we were shooting for, right? I speak for Isabella that we... She threw grammar out the window. What an amazing view of a...
Easy on the eyes.
And I'll throw her under the bus on the grammar stuff there, too, because she's not here.
One other item, though. Under number 2, let's see, of Roman numeral 1, it's a chart where everything else is sort of in words.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And for consistency, maybe that ought to be in words instead of a chart.
Oh, I liked it.
It was. There was some unfortunate person that said that you're saying the same thing over and over and just changing the dollar amount. So I put in a table instead. But, you know, if you want to go back to words, I'm sure that can be accommodated.
I think whatever. Just both ways.
Because my motto is, if you can't be right, be consistent.
Understood.
Good motto.
And I didn't have any history on this, like some of you may have.
How can...
I don't think there was much history on this, to be honest with you.
After the entire board now has seen this, how do you want feedback on this prior to the next meeting?
Well, I would take any public feedback at this point in time. Obviously, Irv had some good notes. I appreciate it. Leah's comments on there. Ultimately, I'm going to try to take this feedback and relay it to Isabella. Because she's, again, kind of the primary draft author of this. Unfortunately, she's going to be here tonight, but let's say just kind of going one by one with any, especially any substantive changes or suggestions.
About like after the meeting and stuff like that, if something occurs, just an email to you would be fine, or an email to you and Isabella?
Well, I think, in all honesty, it should be discussed here in the public setting, and if something does occur afterward, make a note of it to yourself and bring it up at the next meeting with the next draft. I think since you and Isabella have communicated with this, you cannot drag in another board member to communicate outside of this forum.
Okay, fair enough. That's why I asked.
No, that's what I think. So I would resist.
Very good.
I mean, you can send it to me, but I would not be able to share that.
Right.
I just have to claim the idea as my own.
There you go.
Yeah.
Okay.
And it's not up for approval tonight either. I mean, this is
right.
Strictly marked as a review item.
Very good.
That's it for comments.
Yeah.
Stephen?
So, first of all, I think it's great that we're finally getting written policy. I don't quite understand. This is for budgeted items, right? So basically what you're saying is these individuals have the authority, if it is a budgeted item, to pull the trigger on these things. I guess I understand this exercise is a way to control our budget. And I'm just trying to imagine what, you know, a $5,000 expense would be, or a $15,000 expense would be, other than an emergency. I mean, it's a significant amount of money, and if it's not brought before the board and the public, then, you know, it kind of short circuits the public process. So can you kind of help me understand what...
I can actually give you an answer from the fire department standpoint.
Sure.
So we prepare the budget, sections, Schedule C, we line out, we need four sets of turnouts in the coming year.
Right.
One set of turnouts together, paint and coat, costs about $2,500. So we recently had two new employees, they both needed new turnouts. I gave Ryan Brackett, who purchases those turnouts for the department, the authority to make the purchase, and that came to roughly $5,000.
Okay. So those are the kinds of
things. So it was planned, it was budgeted, it was under the $5,000 amount threshold. Fire chief authorized it.
Really? So basically what we're talking about is purchase or decision-making authority for those budgeted items. Nothing above and beyond. I guess the reason why this has come up, we've done some projects that Shane has initiated. I'm not criticizing Shane, but they were pretty expensive projects, and I was surprised that it never came before the board, and I think I mean we just need to make sure that we're doing this correct, and we're not getting ourselves in hot water, because everyone is operating independent of the discipline of the financial manager here. Ultimately, it's your responsibility if these expenditures are misspent. What is a $15,000? Just give me an idea. What would you be buying for $15,000 that wouldn't warrant bringing before the board?
The T-shirts.
But that's a budgeted item, though. That's clearly labeled out in Schedule C.
Oh, that's what I'd be saying.
So, mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we have department heads to run the business, a district manager to run the business. We've gone through the budgetary process. The budgetary process is a public event. The public gets to weigh in on it. The board gets to weigh in on it. These items are approved, many of them in detail. So to come back to the board to say, hey, you already approved us doing this once. Will you please approve it again? Is a waste of the board's time.
So as long as there's enough detail in the budget, I guess there's not a problem. I just, like I said, want to not run away with expenses.
Right. Understood.
Well, and I agree with your initial comment. I think this is a step in that direction.
Right.
It certainly provides lines of accountability, authority, and where those don't exist. I'd give you an example of a budgeted item that is written into this budget that would exceed all of these thresholds and go to the board is the fire department would like to purchase a new utility truck. That is written into the budget that right now has a tagline of about $35,000. Before any of that purchase is made, those details will come to the board, be presented in public settings, or it'll be at a time where we're able to look at, okay, how are we actually performing? Is this a required expense? Is this an affordable expense? Is this an expense the district has the funds by which to make at this point in time, or should this be deferred for another year? That would be an example of a budgeted line that needs further scrutiny before the trigger is pulled, so to speak.
Okay.
So just now, just as an example, I hate to keep bringing it up, but the remediation of the mold was right around five grand for one expense. What is that classified as? Is that classified as an emergency expense?
Yes.
Yeah, it was an actual health hazard. We needed to get that squared away as quick as possible. And that company came highly recommended from the County of Marin's Health Environmental Services Department. Mm-hmm. And they were, I called them, they were here the next day testing. That was like on, I called them on a Thursday, they're there on a Friday.
Well, you have to act quickly. I understand. I just was trying to understand, you know. You can lose that $35,000 that you want to set aside for that utility vehicle if we take a five grand.
Trust me, I know.
Yeah.
Yeah. Believe me, I've been dealing with mold in kitchen.
Right.
Yeah. Thanks, Stephen. District manager report.
Is that it for public comment on that?
I think everybody had. Stephen was the only one that.
Okay. Without reading the whole thing, you know, word for word here, obviously, you know, some of the big things that are on this agenda, still working with the storm-related property damage. I attended an OES briefing in Santa Rosa. There were several members of various agencies from Marin County there, as well as Sonoma County, and I believe it also incorporated Napa County. At the end of the day, I feel very confident that our situation will be covered. We will receive funding assistance through this. It's a process. It takes some time. At this point in time, I've submitted the documentation that needs to be submitted, and they have confirmed receipt of that documentation. They have not confirmed a what they call a kickoff meeting, and my big takeaway from that was don't do any work until that kickoff meeting, at which point we will be assigned a very specific case number that goes towards that. The end of the day, I'm anticipating of what our total costs are, this will probably cover roughly 93% of our direct costs, plus it'll also cover a lot of our indirect costs, meaning any staff time that is put towards this stuff, things like that can all be written towards it, plus any prep work that we did can be written towards this, things like the community sand and sandbags that we set up can be written towards this event. They have recently declared basically the month of February as a disaster for Marin County as well. Our damage all pretty much occurred in January, and anything that happened in February as a result of those storms was actually further damage to things that looked at in January. The primary areas I'm looking at again are behind the pool shed, the northern field, creek bank over there. That's really it at this point in time. I am actually halfway investigating things like that eucalyptus tree that was on there. Might very well be able to be, because that certainly occurred during the January 3rd through 12th period, and that was a result of that, and us needing to take it out. Unfortunately for the residents who went there, it wouldn't do that, but our remediation of the second tree, it would. So I feel confident that we'll do that, but again, this is a process. You're talking about working with state and federal level people in OES as well as FEMA. And with that, the other item of note here is they certainly have environmental specialists on their team who know how to navigate through some of these environmental requirements. We're gonna have to be very sensitive and aware of, because the work and the damage occurred right alongside a protected waterway. So that was interesting to talk. And then finally, I did bring out a geotech engineer from Miller Pacific Engineering Group out of Novato. He did a an observation assessment on it, and then came up with a follow-up where he actually got down into the creek and really looked at it. He is putting together a proposal to do further testing. His initial assessment is the same, that you know, with each passing day at this point in time, the danger of further damage lessens, but it needs to be addressed.
Along those lines with the creek, do we also take into consideration County Fire Road slide? I mean, because there's part of that that's going to start to go. If I was reading how these storms were affecting that pathway, and how, for one reason or another, that we're going to have to cover if there's damage down the road from that. I walked Blackstone Canyon and found a cut-in up above finally, and there was at least two slides along that pathway that I noticed. One was fairly good size and took out a good chunk out of that pathway. So things were happening.
Yeah, it is possible.
That's the fire road that's going to go away in the not so distant future.
Hopefully, yes.
Well, as a fire road, I don't think you get it.
No, trust me, fire roads is a whole different set of headaches for me right now.
No, because I mean, it's narrow, it's almost a single path right now.
And a lot of those also fall into different categories.
Okay.
And then what we're looking at, but it's certainly, Chief and I have been exploring that, and it's a good point to bring up, Bill, and we will look into it deeper, and if it can be included, we certainly would include it within there. The difference is here is we have, you know, actual kind of
serious damage.
Well, damage to the area. I mean, it's tangible and it's there, as opposed to this could happen farther down the line, kind of a thing. But once we open up the claim, it's open for a long time until we say it's exhausted and we've done everything that we've discovered as a result of this storm event. The other thing within the report here is Chief Shane and myself went to Sacramento for a day, attended what's known as the Safety and Claims Education Day through our P&L and comp carrier, SDRMA. It was certainly a good day. I think we all got a little bit of valuable information on it. We were able to be up and back in a day, and then as an added bonus, this will actually impact our rates for 17, 18, and hopefully goes down.
Reduce them?
It will apply a discount to them, yes. Awesome. Won't reduce the rates, it'll just apply a discount to them.
The paragraph about the slide on the creek.
Yes.
It appears to focus on the one area behind the pump house.
Yes.
It would seem that if you're going to have Eric out here analyzing that area, at the same time he ought to be analyzing the area off the...
He did. He brought him down there.
Okay, because that isn't what it...
Sorry. I guess I was just kind of looking at it from that imminent sense of urgency in this spot here, because if something were to go there and all of a sudden damage occurs to the pump house and we're shutting down the pool for the whole year or something like that. But no, he inspected both areas. He wanted to further inspect this area, but he's certainly going to also incorporate a bit of a proposal for there. But this right now is strictly on testing, and I can also tell you through the OES and FEMA, just because he gives us a proposal, we're going to have to put this out and bring in other...
Not for a consulting contract like this.
No, not simply to come out and tell us what is the damage and how quickly will it happen, but when the work comes... He's
construction work.
Yes.
Not what Eric does.
Correct. Yes. Right now, all he is doing is assessing damage and the possibilities of future damage.
Because ultimately, what he's going to give you is a set of recommendations.
Correct.
Then you're going to have you deal with either them or some other firm to come up with a repair plan that you can put out to bid.
Correct.
And it ought to be done for both areas at the same time as one.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. Anybody? Moving on to the fire department. Draft minutes of the fire commission.
I'll touch on most of what we talked about as I go through the report, but I have to say that Dan Curran has been a great addition to the Fire Commission. I think he brings up a lot of good points. He's got some great background and experience, and Russ is really filling in well as the president.
Cool.
So I feel like that I'm getting some great feedback from those guys. Any questions on the activity report? You know, busy calls, day-to-day stuff. It says they were pretty busy in the month of March, especially Brandon Sabatello and Ryan Brackett preparing for the Central Marin Training Consortium training block, where they were responsible for delivering the training, which was auto extrication, which included a classroom portion and a field exercise to all the engine companies, Marinwood, San Rafael, Kentfield, Marchburg, Cordillera. All the guys on shift helped make that happen, but it's a big undertaking. There's different block trainings that go on through the course of the year, and we're one small fire department, and we're responsible for delivering as much as an agency like San Rafael is, and our guys step up and do a great job. So I'll touch on a couple other things. The commission looked at the fire department budget. They had some good feedback. They'll see it again next month. The CERT kiosk has kind of been put on hold. I took it back to our CERT steering committee. They're still very divided on what they think should happen with that project. Jeff came to the CERT steering committee and had some great feedback from the board standpoint. It was very well received, too. They appreciated you coming. So at this point, they're going to kind of work amongst themselves and see what they actually want to do. And again, there's a lot of other ways to get information out rather than a big giant bulletin board. So, unfortunately, one of our new paramedics took a job with Marin County Fire. I knew this was a possibility when we hired him. I thought it was going to come much later in the year. Unfortunately, it came sooner. So Dean has moved on to Marin County Fire Department. I'm sure he'll have a wonderful career there. With that being said, we still have Sean Day and Dan Rotwein as paramedics in the department. They continue to do ongoing training and go to CQI trainings. We're still kind of up and running. I have a current list of paramedics. We do not have a current opening, although I kind of expect one of our long-term disability injuries to play itself out one way or the other in the near future. I did talk to San Rafael. They plan on hiring a new hire academy. Probably late summer at that point, we'll hire another paramedic. So at this point, and I expect the other workers' compensation injury to return hopefully in early May. So we're going to roll with 9, and the vacation relief position will be open at this point through the summer, unless strike teams become abundant and have to bring on a temporary firefighter at that point. I'll re-examine that possibility. We have an engineer's exam coming up in May. There's two guys who are qualified and certified to take the test. They're actually both in the room, Jeff and Sean, so hopefully they're studying up and getting ready for that. That brings us to kitchen. I've learned way too much about mold and SB 854 over the last 2 months. And I continue to learn more. And we've had some low bids come in that we haven't been able to use. Leah, I call it Mylan Construction. That's the bid that I have before you. Unfortunately, we can't use them because they're not a DIR registered company. But I wanted to get the bid just to get a ballpark number. I did receive a bid this past weekend, which I forwarded you from AG Construction, who is a DIR registered company and who does pay prevailing wage. And you saw the number before you. It's ridiculous. That kind of leads me back to ground zero. Where do we go from here? Jeff gave me an RFP from El Toro Fire Department. I talked to one of their captains who was involved in the project. The guy who ran the project is on duty tomorrow. I'm going to talk to him. They put in their RFP that they wanted their kitchen remodel, which is almost identical to what we want done, to be $25,000. They ended up paying $59,000 for it. I'm hoping to get back without appliances. I'm hoping to get back from this guy tomorrow a list of all the DIR companies that bid on the project. I'm also going to write an RFP. I think what we need to do is write an RFP, get it out, advertise it where we need to, have a date for sealed bids, publicize this as best we can, get as many sealed bids from DIR companies that pay prevailing wage, open them up and see what we got. Unfortunately, it pushes the project out about another month or so, but I don't see any other way to proceed other than following the law. Unfortunately, I've learned about the law. You know, ignorance was bliss. I was ready to build the kitchen for $24,000, but that might have put us all kind of in some sort of a liability standpoint. At this point, I think we move forward with that plan. I talked to Eric about it. I tend to agree. You know, I don't see any other way to move forward. I can tell you this, is that one private member of the public who's here tonight sitting behind me made a very generous offer to pay for the kitchen directly to someone, to a construction company. We checked with county council. They said, no, it doesn't matter. You're trying to circumvent the law. If anyone filed suit or protested this, you would lose. So I'm all about taking $100 bills to pay for a kitchen. We just can't do it.
So,
yeah, I know. Scratch your head, right? Government spending.
So the law says we have to find a contractor who is licensed by the state of California.
They have to have a building license,
contractor's license,
right.
Of course. But registered, mm-hmm. that they're paying, what do they call it?
Prevailing wages.
Amongst other things.
A plumber comes to your house, you pay him $50 an hour. A plumber comes onto a government job, gets prevailing wage, it's $200 an hour. And those aren't exact dollar amounts, but that's about the cost of the markup.
One size fits all. Los Angeles County pays the same amount that Marinwood.
I think prevailing wage can differ slightly from county to county.
No, you get my point.
Yeah, exactly.
So bringing up Los Angeles County and reading this law, Los Angeles County and two or three other entities in the state of California have exemptions to this law.
Do they really?
Yes. I'd like to know why and how. That would be interesting.
Yes. If you have any information on it, forward it to me. We'll vet it through county council. I'll make phone calls.
Yeah.
What's crazy about this is I call these companies. These companies are huge. They bid on big, giant contracts to build airports, freeways. Nobody's like, it's a mom and pop shop that we need to come in here and build us a kitchen. Those aren't DIR registered companies. This guy, Alex. He said he does jobs between $150,000 to $1 million. And he came in here and he looked at this. He's like, yeah, this is going to be expensive if you got to follow the law. I go, I don't know a way around it. Go.
There must be a hardship application. Like, that brings up because the project that I'm doing right now, and it's going through the City of San Rafael with permits, they're in conjunction with applying for the building permits. There's also a hardship application for a part of the project that would be too costly in terms of ADA compliance and whatever, that it's not worth doing. And so my understanding is that that's sort of also a part of doing business with these types of things, is, you know, there's offsets. So maybe is it possible to see if there's some kind of offset or hardship application? Because yes, for a small agency, for something that should cost $25,000 to bump it up to $75 or $100, that seems...
We've explored as many avenues as we can.
But what happens if you just don't even? What would be the ramifications of the law? Let's say they go with a mom and pop shop, spend $25,000. What does that open this up to liability-wise? I mean, would
people, companies who weren't allowed to bid on the project could sue the district, and the penalty is $15,000 per agency who files suit. I think
$100 a day, up to a max. I think of. $15,000, not to mention. He recently registered his company with DIR, but I'm not saying that you got penalized. I'm saying, and it also has a 2-year some level. Actually, I think if any group that works on this. Without that, has a 2-year restriction from being able to participate in future government jobs, so on and so forth. It's it is the efficiency of government inefficiencies, without a doubt. I mean, we've gone through council. I've gone through
couple times
with multiple questions. I've put this out to special district consultants that this is what they do. I've gone out to the CSDA on this, but we've talked to other local special districts in addition to ones across the state and locally. I mean, the kind of thing is, I don't want to be the one to test these waters to you. It's, I mean, could we go out there? Could we bring somebody in to do the work? And is there a chance that nobody will decide to file a complaint on it? Yes, that's not a decision I'm going to make.
That was the problem, is I didn't want to make the, be the guy that made that decision.
What if the work, what if it's do-it-yourself stuff? What if there are things that, pieces that can be done in-house?
So we talked a little bit about that, things like buying the appliances. The district bought the appliances directly. You know, we avoid the cost of markup. We just have to provide the appliances and the dimensions to whoever does the work so they can install it. Probably lose out on some warranty things by doing it that way. You know, the guys have offered to complete the demo. If that, you know, there's some savings there. I don't know about the rest of that, though. Like I don't think Home Depot is an option. Is there an EIR registered?
I have a question. I'm sure you've done all your homework, and I just want to piggyback Leah's original question that if you do put this out to bid and you follow all the proper avenues of advertising for it, and no one bids, then do you fall under the same liability if you go to mom and pop's shop to come in?
Well, that would be an interesting scenario.
I haven't made it that far yet.
I don't think that's in the facts section of the DIR website, Brandon, but it is actually a very good question to ask, and I think that would have to be a bridge that we would have to cross when the time comes. I mean, we'd have to put the bid out in very specific ways, you know, through advertisements on the paper, local builders associations, through certain things. I think, unfortunately, realistically, people have already bid on it that are registered with, you know what I mean, informally, not through an RFP process, and I'm sure that they would simply resubmit. But to your point, it's an interesting question, and maybe they wouldn't. I mean, I don't know, but I think that...
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, no, it would be Marin Builders, Sonoma County Builders, you know, Solano, Contra Costa, you know, all of them.
Yeah, so the whole, all of Los Angeles County has an exemption from this on any public works project?
I believe so. I'll go back. There are at least three entities that were listed.
Okay.
I remember somewhere, I think, either in water or sewer districts. I mean, a lot of those are written in at the time the legislation is done, and they could just be through trailer bills or through... you know, anytime legislation is there and it's proposed to be passed, there's always people saying, well, I want my other thing passed, so exempt me here and we'll exempt you there. You know, I mean, it's government shystiness, but we can certainly look into how did these guys be exempted as the law was written. From there, I mean, I don't want to seem optimistic towards it. I mean, we've certainly tried to run through variances that we could find and exemptions that we could find. I mean, the other thing I would say is it's very frustrating to all of us that it is becoming such a process in the essence that I think everybody just wanted to have a kitchen done at this point in time. And unfortunately, such is government work. I certainly commend, appreciate, and publicly thank, you know, not only Captain Salvatella and firefighter, you know, Smith and Dave that are in here, but the entire fire department is just, you know, now for what's going on several weeks or, well, it's not, I mean, they have some basic uses there, you know, they don't have a sink, they don't have a dishwasher in there, the floor has been ripped out, they've been incredibly patient, understanding, and accommodating with it, so thank you guys and share that to everybody, and, but at the end of the day, we want to get this done as quickly as well as you know, as efficiently and economically as we can afford to.
So I'm just trying to come up with a game plan to wrap my head around it.
Yeah.
But we'll look into like a hardship exemption. I'll look to see how LA County got some sort of an exemption. I'll talk to Damon about Connolly about it. In the meantime, I'm also going to put together this RFP and come up with a time schedule for advertising it and accepting sealed bids back.
A couple of things. First, I know a guy with a food truck. Second, Eric, about a month or so ago, told me about this assembly mill and asked, you know, why aren't I registered? And about a week after he told me about it, which was the first time I ever heard of it, I get a notice from the County of Marin, new law in effect. Well, it started in about 2014.
April 2015.
But it goes back to the dating of things is in 2014. In any event, I'm now registered, but I only had to pay a $2,000 fine or penalty. So, plus of course the registration fee that they say, and it has to be renewed every year. And they don't tell you what the renewal is.
$300 every year.
That's what I guess.
Can you build a kitchen?
No.
To be registered.
Sorry, I can't build a kitchen. But you know, that just seems to be there. But you're trying to find a way to deal with this, and I think you're missing a big step possibly. And that is from, I just scanned this the proposal from
Alex,
AKA general contractor, whatever. And he talks about the need for a building permit and the need for, because it's not a residential kitchen, the need for a health department permit.
No, I've actually resolved that issue with county. I spent some time over county planning Friday afternoon and talked to Bill Kelly, and they've changed it into a residential application.
That's good, but you still need to make an application.
Yeah, but
are you going to be able to do it without any detailed plans?
No, I'll need three sets of architectural plans.
But you probably need that before you can go out and get proposals, because they need to know what they're bidding on.
Sort of. I think you can give these guys a general idea on what the size of what we need, and they can get us pretty close.
And then they'll add and add and add and add. We didn't know you meant that, and we didn't know you meant that, and this wasn't included. Without a set of plans, you're at their mercy.
We spent a year trying to get quotes on the community center kitchen, and everybody laughed at us when we told them the budget. We couldn't find anybody. I think we had six people come through, and no one wants to get near it.
Yep. They don't want to touch it. I don't know why. I got a couple of buddies who are generals who said they'll build us a kitchen in 2 weeks, but
okay, thank you. I have looked at SB 854 and also the labor code that is related to it about public works work in government agencies. And nowhere does it say the public cannot, or a private person cannot pay for it. Nowhere does it say that. It only refers to public money, public tax money. If you have the government, you know, the district paying for it, then you have to go through SB 854 and the labor code. But it's all government money. Nowhere does it say a private person can't give you a $25,000 envelope in cash to pay for it. Nowhere. And I don't understand, Eric, why the county council is saying can't do it that way.
I ran this past council. I'm happy to discuss it open. It's an attorney-client privileged thing. You guys would need to tell me to discuss it out loud. Mm-hmm. I'm happy to do that. It's not that critical of a thing. And in a nutshell, they advised against it, and I can give you the rationale behind that, but I can't breach their attorney-client privilege without this board's direction.
Can I try to answer it without breaching any privilege?
Well, since you haven't seen it, sure.
So we do what's called special assessment districts, and there they collect the money from the property owners in the district.
Right.
And that money pays for the work. Mm-hmm. But because it goes through the public agency, it has to be done as a public project. It's probably the exact same rationale. Not that I agree with it, but that's just the way it's interpreted.
Mm-hmm. It's talking about public money. Period.
I know, but they
not private
somehow
money.
It becomes public when you sort of pass it through.
You're trying to circumvent the law.
Yeah.
But it doesn't say that anywhere in the law.
The opinion is if we got challenged on it, we would lose. That's the opinion. If another contracting agency came in and said, hey, you guys are trying to circumvent the law, they decided to take it to court, they decide to look at it, the opinion is we lose that now.
Steven?
Yeah, well,
I love the idea.
I have a question and then also a possible suggestion. First of all, is there a minimum? You know, if we hire, say, a plumber, does that...
$1,000.
No, what I'm saying, does that plumber have to be a DIR?
Any project over $1,000.
Oh, it's $1,000.
Yeah.
Okay, so I guess what I was thinking is if you could divide it up into smaller projects. But...
They've looked at... And Shane might even be able to speak to this a little bit more because actually about a year ago he sat through a webinar on all of this. I mean, they're looking for districts that are and government agencies that are trying to break this up into, hey, it's not a $25,000 project. We're actually doing six $4,000 projects instead. I mean, so it's one of those things that it does. I am not defending what any of these government codes are. I think they're ridiculous, and I think it's junk, and I think it's presenting a hardship. I'm looking out for the liability of the district.
Well, I remember
you got to be careful here.
Yeah, Tom Horn talking about the $25,000 shade structure up in Upper Loose Valley because of all the government requirements. Okay, so here's a recommendation, building on what I had talked about the last meeting. I believe what you should do is put in a freestanding kitchen. This is what restaurants do, where you have like stainless steel units. They're freestanding units. You bring them in. They're high quality. There's no contract work. They cost, you know, tables cost from anywhere from a couple $100 to about $3,500. That kitchen's not that big. What's the dimensions of the kitchen, roughly?
I don't know offhand.
Yeah, it's like a standard.
Yeah, it's a standard horseshoe shape.
Yeah, so if you were to put in, say, 3 8-foot units plus a sink, you're maybe talking about $10,000, and that's something that comes in the door. So if you had that place all tiled up, basically you're hiring somebody for electric, plumbing, and tile work, and you'd save a whole bunch of costs. And you'd have a decent kitchen, too. I mean, that's what Michelin chefs use, so I don't think you would be skimping at all in terms of quality.
It's a public works project.
Where do we go?
Well, what I'm saying is, okay, so...
I kind of know in my mind
you're
what I need to do to kind of move this along while researching a couple other things.
Okay.
Eric, we're kind of on the same page with that?
Yeah, I mean, I think we're at the point of taking this model RFP that we have, I think it's a good RFP, putting it together and issuing it. I mean, I think that's where it is. In all honesty,
and it sounds like this is what we have to do. We're forced to do.
I can tell you that every other fire chief in this county is following SB 854. Right. And a couple of them said they are not going to be the test case.
Sure.
Relative to your timing issue, I know from talking to someone today who was trying to ask me if there wasn't a way around it, the building department now is saying at least 3 weeks before they'll even look at a set of plans for an application.
They could do it one day. In a residential application, if whoever we select has the plans, they can schedule an appointment and do, I forget what they call it, but it's a same-day plan check.
Is this through the county?
Yeah.
All these people want to do is reclass your pool.
Well, they didn't show up in uniform, I guess.
Are we exhausted? Are we done? Next meeting, May 2nd?
Yes.
As long as Park and Rec. Drafting it. And we're going to head to the minutes and then into the next RFP.
Quite that far along. Any questions on the minutes? Comments?
The minutes for
Park and Rec.
Park maintenance facility.
I have a question.
I'm sorry. Did somebody say draft minutes?
Yes.
I didn't hear you.
Okay.
I would like to make one change.
Okay.
And it's a very small change, but under the draft minutes, number three, I never said that kids will create bike jumps into the creek. What I said was, I didn't think that that narrow pathway that goes, according to the pictures, the drawing, that goes along the creek would be, I thought it would be a liability because I thought children, dogs, even adults walking their dogs would create pathways down into the creek. Never even thought of bike jumps. That's all. Thank you.
Yeah, actually I did have one. If you can indulge me for a second.
One second.
Okay, so I'm a little concerned about the tennis association's great. They do good things. I'm a little concerned about any kind of commitments we make with them on a long-term basis. I don't know exactly what their revenue is, or what revenue they bring to us, but that is a park facility, and we want to make sure that the people that actually pay for that facility have equal access to the courts. Maybe you can address that. Is there a rent, or what is the financial arrangements there?
We have no long-standing commitment with them. They rent our courts.
An hourly basis?
Yeah, on an hourly basis. And they also have donated, I believe, $10,000 in the last few years.
And is that comparable to what they would get elsewhere? Or?
Some places charge more. Some don't have a fee for, residential groups. So.
Yeah. Well, I think they're a great group. I just want to make sure that we don't shortchange ourselves.
Yeah.
I missed that part of the meeting because I was at the CERT meeting. What exactly was the point of it?
So we've had an ongoing relationship with the Marinwood Tennis Association. Fairly recently, they contacted us, the rec department, and wanted to be introduced to the commission and then eventually the board, just to touch base, let you guys know what they're up to. I think they're starting to get more organized on their end, so they have different positions and whatnot. I think long-term, they have a vision of keeping the courts in good repair and seeing what they can do as far as fundraising and also what the commitment of the board is going to be long-term.
So sort of a more formal organization, and also it sounds like some cooperation with the district and maintaining the tennis courts, or perhaps even improving them.
Right, which has been happening on a more casual basis, but I think, like you mentioned, they want to have a little more formalized relationship.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Is it just the four courts that we have here, or is it?
They utilize all the courts in some capacity.
Okay.
Yeah.
And how are the courts doing?
The front two courts are good.
Yeah. Oh, so the ones on the way to Mother Creek School are still in need of repair, or?
Well, we didn't really repair them, we painted them.
You painted them?
Yeah.
I see. Is there a problem?
Yeah.
Is there?
Yeah.
Is this another, we talked about this, I think, in the fixed assets.
Yeah, it's on there.
Yeah.
Eventually, those are going to need to be completed.
Is that a couple of years after?
Yeah, it's not next year. I think it's not higher than priority list as far as we're concerned.
Understood. Thanks.
Park maintenance facility replacement initiative update.
Great. I mean, this update, there's not, in terms of progress and action on the, it's pretty much the same outside of kind of communication efforts, setting this upcoming meeting for April 25th, which will be a valuable time for district staff, board, park and rec commission to listen to the community, try to collect their thoughts as best as we can. I think there's a good plan going into that meeting as to how that meeting will go, or at least the flow and format of that meeting. I included a couple of things that have been put out to the community at this point in time, as well as you know, we've kind of bolstered up our website. It's got a separate page now dedicated to this. It's being utilized to get the word out about this meeting. We've printed these up in large and placed them on sandwich boards outside in the immediate area where the current facility is. We've posted it out front. We've posted it over here. We've put it out on next door. I've put it out on the Mayberry's email distribution list, and then I will bump it up again on, you know, kind of next door and out there, and hoping to get as many people. We're going to personally, I'm going to draft a letter and personally invite the immediate neighbors that live immediately adjacent to that area, as well as send them these materials as well, and cordially invite them to please come, please participate, please provide your feedback. And right now we are waiting for that meeting to be able to move forward. I mean, no decisions have been made other than we're having a meeting on this day and we need to replace the shed. In terms of what that replacement looks like, no decisions have been made there, nothing has moved forward, and everything will stem from that community workshop where we'll be able to kind of finalize, not finalize, but start to polish ideas, most likely bring in a professional design architect to start really looking at the area, space ratios, and everything else.
This is going to be post-budget, correct?
Yes, yes. April 25th at 6 p.m. is the budget.
Room?
Everything will be in this room.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, unfortunately, the community hall is booked up that night.
So we'll have the placement, I guess we'll have a layout, beautiful little.
They're not little, generously printed out.
On the side.
What are the dimensions of those?
They're 24 by 36.
Big.
Yeah.
Of the two site layout options at this point in time, as you know, kind of created and proposed by Mr. Runko. Again, none of that has been decided. These are simply to be used to help generate conversation, to help provide some level of idea, thoughts to within this community workshop is in terms of location and placement in that general area. They are, one isn't preferred over the other at this point in time. It is simply, let's hear what the community has to say, and this is going to be the forum to do that.
Have we gotten any feedback or response as of yet?
No, not really. We haven't gotten any calls on it outside of comments that have been made in these meetings. Nobody else, but again, I plan to personally reach out to the neighbors there, and I've gotten to know quite a few of them too, and encourage them to attend and help them to spread the word, encourage their immediate neighbors to attend. And that's really where it is at this point in time.
Okay. Steve?
Well, first of all, I think of the two options that Herb talked about, I don't think either one of them are within the legal building envelope on that site, because you have to be 100 feet away from the stream. Anyhow, so I think that is going to be a huge issue. I would I would recommend that you look at an entirely different option. And that is, and Chief's not going to like this, but to build an extension off like a shed or a drive-through shed or something long where you could put the vehicles in there. And then I don't know how important the workshop portion of it is, the storage part. Maybe that can go somewhere else. But this right next to the firehouse is probably going to be the least political position. To put it, it will be legal, and I don't know that anyone would be able to stop it, even though I don't like the idea of it, but perhaps something could be created that looks good.
Wherever you guys decide to put it is fine with me.
No, that is fine. That's interesting.
I don't
on the other side of the firehouse.
Yeah, I mean, that would make the most sense. You see it from the road, but you don't have any neighbors that would really complain about that, I don't believe. They wouldn't like to see it from the road. But it would be the only option that gets you away from the politics of over here and also the environmental concerns, which I believe are significant.
I was just thinking of access.
Let's have the community workshop first before we start making decisions and opinions.
Well, I just think just game plan, just see if it works. I don't know, maybe it won't work, but I think it's a worthwhile look-see.
That's where we were supposed to put
the kiosk.
Yeah.
Cool.
But
save it for the meeting.
The reason I want to bring it up now is because maybe it might. There's a few clinkers that are going to. I'm going to bring up the 100-foot rule because I think it's important.
But, that's why we're having the meeting.
Okay. But I know the neighbors are going to look. Some of the neighbors, a couple of the neighbors, are going to look for any little thing that they can to prevent a big structure behind their house.
I just know what.
Yeah. The other option would be maybe right as you come in, but all you have to do is take 100 feet and try to measure in that area. There's no place to put it.
Anybody else? Linda?
I did want to ask two quick questions. One, is there an RFP, or is somebody still working on an RFP for this?
Not as yet.
Oh, well, I thought Eric was... Haven't you been working on it for 6 months now?
No. It's not at a point where it's ready for an RFP.
Oh, okay. I thought I saw it in some status reports that you've been working on it.
Mm-hmm. And we've moved it back to this step at this point.
Okay. The other question I had is, and I apologize for being 3 minutes late, so I don't know if anyone caught this mistake about the date and time of the Park and Rec meeting and the special board meeting and that kind of thing. Did anybody bring that up? Okay, because here you have the next Park and Rec commission meeting is where you're going to have the public come in and talk about it. Okay, April 25th, 2017, and that's at 7:30. Then below, you have a special board meeting, April 25th, 2017, at 7:30. You really mean 6 o'clock, I think, for the special board meeting.
I don't know where you're looking right now.
I'm sorry. I'm looking at the very bottom of the agenda.
No, that's not what I...
At the very bottom of the
agenda. Yeah, I understand.
You've got two meetings at the same exact time.
I know.
And the special board meeting is supposed to be the 6 p.m. budget hearing that was referenced.
You are right.
In
so
the
there should actually be a third line in there that should say 6 p.m. and the 7:30. So Linda brings up a good point. Right now, I know that Irv and Jeff have committed to coming to this community workshop. However, if any other board members are there, it is going to become a notice public meeting of the board. At which point it will become a joint meeting of a special meeting of the board combined with a joint meeting of the Park and Rec Commission.
So do you not want to come?
I would encourage you to come. I would encourage all board members to be there. It's just for the sake of when it becomes a meeting of the board that needs to be noticed. If there's going to be more than two board members there, it becomes a special meeting of the board. In this particular situation, it will become a joint meeting with a special meeting of the board in conjunction with a regular meeting of the Park and Rec Commission. So it just is a matter on how it gets noticed. I was anticipating it happening that at least three board members, if not all five, would be there. And I personally would encourage all of you to be there. It just is a matter of how it gets noticed.
Okay.
Okay, so let's
put it. Are you talking about the special meeting of the board?
Yes.
For the budget hearing?
No, I'm talking about the
special meeting
of the board for this community workshop.
So you've got two special meetings.
Correct. That's why I say it should actually have a third line on there that says 6 p.m. at the budget hearing. But it doesn't. I didn't put that on this particular thing. But that meeting exists. It's been said it will be noticed. I'm saying if more than two members of the board show up to this community workshop or intending on showing up, then I would prefer to notice it as a special meeting of the board. So that way it is known that the board will be there. The board will be discussing an item of district business. In addition to, it'll be a joint meeting is what it will become.
Okay, well, as long as you know what you're talking about, because I sort of understand, but I don't care. Thank you.
You're welcome, thank you.
Also, before this meeting, I really, you're talking about hiring an architect, but I mean, we're here tonight, DIR is really going to throw a big loop here. I think the reality is you're going to end up with a prefab unit. And I would encourage you to reach out to other parks departments and go, you've got this problem too, how do you solve it?
That's not the architect I'm referring to, and Irv can probably speak better to this than
you
I can.
Site plan?
Not a site plan. Irv, you want to jump in on this in terms of coming out of this community workshop, what do you think would be in terms of a designer?
Well, hopefully we're going to get some good ideas from the community as to location, orientation, the kind of building they would like, and other things, lighting, sound, landscaping to screen it, all that.
Yeah.
And then the board will synthesize that into some kind of a scope of what we want. Then we'll go out to a RFP for an architect to actually start the process of preparing drawings so we can get permits and move on with it.
Well, I guess what I'm saying is, looking at the financial realities, I think you're going to be ending up with a prefab unit, as every parks department I've ever seen has utilized. And I would suggest certainly take input from the public, but bring in some good ideas of your own. I just think if you don't, you're really asking for a mashup that you're not going to be able to control.
Okay, so
this has come a long way from a $20,000 prefab.
Oh, one other thing, Eric. I think if you post there's a lot of foot traffic down there, dog walkers and whatever. If you post directly on the shed itself.
There is a post there.
There is a post there? I didn't notice that.
Yeah, okay. I saw it today.
Oh, okay.
There's a post and there's also one of those.
Can we move
things
on?
All right, okay.
Yeah,
thank you. Okay, recreation and park maintenance activity report.
Yes, the recreation department has been working diligently and getting summer up and running. Summer camps are pretty much sold out. Swim lessons are headed that direction as well. The pool we haven't had any issues with, getting that up and running. I did note in there that we have somebody coming out in the next few weeks to look at our pool shell to give us a quote.
Pool shell?
The main
pool plaster?
Yeah. Because we are losing quite a bit of water. And it's hard to tell exactly how much is seeping through the shell versus opening up to the atmosphere. So that'll happen in the next couple of weeks, so we can at least have a ballpark idea on that. This Saturday, we have the Las Colinas egg hunt and breakfast with Bunny here at the Marinwood Park. Always a great event. We have John's Donuts that will be here this year with their donut truck. Spring break camp is going on right now. It was sold out, extremely successful. In general, the rec staff has been doing an awesome job. Any questions on the rec? Parks department, they're another story. Parks department has been working hard as well. We're still playing catch up, but the guys have been working extremely hard. We've been down at the pool for the majority of the last few weeks. We still have probably another week down there, getting the locker rooms, finalizing the painting down there. They've stained all the benches and tables. They've done a lot of turf repair and irrigation repair, but we're finishing up there fairly shortly. And then we'll be moving on to our turf out here, aerating and dealing with weeds. Since we haven't sprayed, you'll notice quite a bit more weeds in the community, so it's taken us quite a bit of time to make the rounds. So hopefully, we took care of some of them in the entryway last week as you head into the Marinwood from the Marinwood Market side. And we'll
just kind of bug my house.
Sure. So, guys are busy. The park maintenance truck tomorrow is getting the Marinwood logo put on it. And then hopefully towards the end of next week, we'll be getting the rest of the equipment put on the truck. Everybody's just super busy right now and working hard.
Where's the truck go for all the equipment?
Up to Santa Rosa.
Santa Rosa?
Yeah. Oh. Okay. And we actually got a really good deal. We called and got our initial estimate. And I called a place in the East Bay, two places in the East Bay. And then Marco called the original place back, who he's dealt with in the past, and the guy lowered the prices by about 20%.
So, pick them up truck.
Yeah.
How long do you think it'll be gone?
Supposedly 24 hours. Right. The spraying deadliners, what they said is going to take the longest. So.
Right.
Just
okay.
For the cure. Yeah.
That's good.
Yeah.
Sure.
Has the maintenance contractor done any work this last month? There's nothing indicated here.
They work every Friday that it's not raining. So they didn't work last Friday, or the past. They did not work last, but they didn't do much last Friday, I should say. Yeah, they did the meetings out front of the community center was the last thing they did. They'll be doing the island on Miller Creek in Las Galinas this upcoming week if it's not raining, and then they'll be moving back to Lucas Valley the following week and start mowing all over again.
The path of
are they going to move into trimming the trees at some point? Because they're moving out. The trees are moving out into the bike lane again.
No, I pulled them completely off of dealing with any of that.
I thought we dealt with that at the board.
Yeah, that everybody wanted a custom pruning in front of their house. What we're going to be doing is our park is going to go out there in a few weeks, and we're going to go through, and I'm going to be out there, and we're going to go through meticulously and prune back first the bike lanes, and then we're going to be looking at everything else and pruning stuff back slightly.
Okay, you're going to make it start to look like landscaping instead of a forest.
Yeah, we're going to try to keep the homeowners out there happy is what we're going to try to do. But yeah, we're going to be doing some pruning, okay. Pruning back a lot of the underbrush.
One last thing, and I don't know if this should be part of this or added to the agenda, but I have this great picture, though I was running out of ink in my printer. But it shows a camper parked on CSD open space where the guy has first put a load of gravel down, and then he keeps his camper on.
Is that across from the mini park?
Yeah,
2260 Las Galinas.
Here it is. Kevin Cadell.
And years back, I had everything there that he had on there. I had him clean it all off, but it's all back again. Well, it's our property now. And
we can
send him a bill for parking on the property.
He's been on and off of that spot for as long as he's lived there, like 25 years.
Well, then it ought to be a big bill. But seriously, do you like anybody park at the end of Burnberry or Loganberry?
Yeah, no, that's not right.
No, we can send him a letter. Don't you need to move your stuff? Clean it up. Yeah, please.
I don't know if anyone noticed the county put up signs down by the market. No parking overnight from 11
to I noticed the bus moved
the
to
bus.
The overpass.
They moved a couple of them, yeah.
It's sometimes when there's traffic, it is blocking view to make that turn.
Well, it's on a slope. I don't know how they're living in that. I mean, they must just keep waking up on the front of the bus.
Steven?
Yeah, I actually have a question. Shane, we've got that old truck, or the truck that was damaged. I haven't seen that move in a really long time.
It's getting donated. Hopefully next week they're going to come pick it up.
Okay. Anything else? It really kind of looks shabby. These are the kinds of things that the neighbors look at and they go, no way.
we don't want any more of it. So, I mean, I think as you position the growth here, saying, look, we understand this, we're going to do it better here, and this is what we want.
I hate to sound like Gary Harrelson, but it's on the list.
Well, I mean, I think you're going to get some blowback at this meeting. I want you.
It actually is on the list. Like, I mean, we're going to get to it shortly.
Yeah.
You're going to ask for gone before the 25th.
Right.
I have a quick question for Shane. Do we still pay the landscapers if they don't work on Fridays when it rains?
Yes, we still pay them.
They come back every day.
They do makeup days later on. It's never like the next week they're here for 2 days. They let us know like quarterly, you have 3 rain days. Is there an area that you need us to spend extra time and attention? So we work with them. So I think we have like 5 rain days.
So are you 100% sure that they make up those rain days?
Yeah, they just recently made up quite a few of them going into the winter. I can't remember what the
winter. Thank you very much.
Okay. So the date of the next park and rec is
the big.
It's April 25th.
Like all the
others. Yes, it's going to be crowded. Okay, new another business. Requests for future meeting agenda items.
Jeff, I know you brought up. Eric, you brought up.
Yeah, we should put for future agenda items the recommended wage increases for the 3 individuals that...
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you. What did you say?
Let's put on the agenda an item for the compensation changes for the 3 individuals that Eric mentioned earlier.
Oh.
Sorry.
Anybody else? Do you have anything going on there?
It is related to the budget, so we don't have to have a separate item.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So that'll be included on the budget.
During the budget. Okay.
Anybody else? Linda?
I've heard every once in a while, and I think it might have been Leah, who said maybe 6 or 8 months ago, social media, perhaps, as an agenda item sometime in the future. Just review the social media rules, because they were kind of pushed through really fast last year by Mr. Kai, and nobody objected, and there was no discussion, and I think by now social media should be in the forefront for all of government agencies. I know it was beginning to last year. So whenever, I mean, it's not a fast, quick request. Okay.
Stephen, you had your hand up, I know.
Yeah, I mean, actually, you've been quite generous and called on me, so I actually don't have much to say. I'm looking forward to some of the items coming up at the next meeting, and I think... some things are going quite well, and I encourage you to keep plugging away. So, thank you.
Nobody has anything else?
No, I have a recognition.
Okay, awesome.
Okay. Well, I did mention this in the Fire Commission meeting, but I would like to mention it to the board members as well. I actually looked at the firefighters' kitchen, or half kitchen as they call it now, and I just want to say that those guys are doing a great job working around all the hazards and the lack of a dishwasher, lack of a sink. I know they're washing their dishes in the shower, but, or maybe it's the toilet. But in any case, they don't have sinks, they don't have a dishwasher, they don't have a lot of storage space, they don't have a lot of countertops, and they're going out and buying extra different kinds of food that is easy to prepare or already prepared. And I just think we should really give a shout out to our firefighters, because they've been doing this for 6 weeks, and it sounds to me like it's going to be at least another 2 months. So I think they're so flexible, and I just think it's great. They're great guys.
If that's all,
under the adjourned item?
Motion.
Do I entertain a motion?
I want to say one thing first. I told Eric, and I want to tell the rest of you, because he had it in one of his missiles to us. He asked, he said it would be important that everyone make it to the April 9th. Was it April 9th?
April 9th.
No, the May 9th meeting, which is when we went out the budget. And I let him know that I will be out of town.
Okay.
So I won't be here. So the meeting will be much quicker anyway.
That's why you got so many budget questions in this one.
You'll have your shut on the 23rd.
Those are good questions, by the way. Thank you. I appreciate it. Your thoughtfulness on it. Here's my recognition.
I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
All those in favor?
Aye.